I had dreams of playing with other musicians and in other bands, but the idea of playing in Miles' band was beyond my dreams. It wasn't possible for me to ever think that I would ever play with Miles Davis. That was just another level that I wasn't, you know, that was in the God level, you know, I wasn't in that level.
Miles happened to come in to the club with his girlfriend at the time, was Betty Mayberry. And, you know, he came into the club and listened to Dave. And after the set, he came up to me and he said, tell the bass player if he gets a ticket and comes to New York, he can work with me. So I told Dave that, and Dave was like, he didn't believe it. You know, he didn't believe that was going to happen. And, you know, sure enough, a ticket came.
My mother calls me in a doctor's office in Brooklyn. I was home at that time. I come from Brooklyn, and she said, Teal Macero, somebody wants you to come to the studio, record Miles Davis. I said, what? I said, come on. So I rushed to the studio, 52nd and Madison, which is where they recorded. I did this track on the corner, first track, whatever it is. He said to me, join the band. He kind of said, join my band.
My friends, you know, we all the musicians, we all knew his voice, and so we would all imitate him, and we would call each other and say, hey, how you doing? You know, so this particular time, he called me, and so he says, Gary, this is Miles Davis. He said, I'd like you to join the band. And so I'm thinking it was one of my friends, you know. I'm saying, who is this? Is this Jack? Come on, Jack, stop playing. He said, no, this is Miles. I said, come on, man. And finally, he began to get irritated, and I realized, oh, man, this is really Miles.
I was playing with him for like 2 months, and he never hired me. He never told me, you are playing with our band now, you know. So I just want him to say that, you know. And I asked him, are we really playing together? What is happening? And he said, did you play yesterday? Did you play last night? And I said, yeah. He said, are you playing tonight? I said, yeah. So?
I had been hearing rumors that Miles was looking for me. And I didn't believe any of those rumors, you know. I was like, Miles Davis, no way, you know. And so as time passed, I was hearing those rumors more and more. So finally, Donald Byrd, who was my roommate, said to me, look, when Miles calls, I said, what do you mean, when Miles calls? He said, he's gonna call, and when he calls, tell him you're not working with anybody. And I said, Donald, I could never do that to you. I mean, you started me off on my career. You introduced me to Alfred Lion and Frank Wolf at Blue Note. You got me my contract. You did all of these things for me. You know, you showed me about publishing and keeping my tunes in my company. I could never do that to you. He said, shut up. He said, if Miles calls, tell him you're not working with anybody. And I said, okay, you know. And the next day, Miles called. And his first question was, you working with anybody? And I said, no.
My experience with Miles is that he was the best listener who also led a band that I've ever seen. Miles is playing an E flat, and I'm holding some kind of E flat fifth on the organ, so it's a constant drone, and he plays an E-flat, which is as in tune as any trumpet player can, that you wouldn't say it's out of tune. But Miles went to his tubing for a split second and tuned it even better. You know, now who would be listening that hard?
The very beginning when I started playing with Miles, he told me once, he told me, don't bang, just play. So, and that was it. So I didn't really understand him, and I thought, okay, don't bang, so maybe I'm, you know, I'm banging things. I'm playing too loud, I thought. So I start playing just, you know, little things like And then he was looking at me the whole concert. And I would pick up another little thing and go, you know, like, because I didn't want to bang, you know. So then next time that he told me anything, then he said, you listen and you play. And in reality, there was very few words, but it was one of the greatest lessons, musical lessons that I ever had. You listen and you play. And that gave me total freedom to play as long as I was listening.
We finally finished this recording, and we go outside to go home. And we're kind of milling about, and John McLaughlin says, Herbie, can I speak to you a minute? I said, sure. So he walks over and he whispers to me. He says, what we did, was it any good or what? I said, John, welcome to a Miles Davis session. Because I said, I don't know, but when the records come out, they sound fine.
I don't think he said three or four words to me about the music, ever, about what to play. He said, once play thirds. I don't know what he meant. You know, I said, I guess play thirds under the melody. I don't know. He would play like, you know. I said, I guess he meant that. I don't know. You know, like, he said very little. And I think that to the other musicians, from what I understand, not only in my time with him, but the past, the musicians in the past and in the 80s, he also said very little.
He would always say, play what you don't know, which means you had to know everything to get back to zero. That was my interpretation of it. But if I look, you listen to Miles and listen to Train, you listen to all them cats, the exploration takes you back to the embryo. You did a whole full life. So 360 is zero. He would always say, I don't want you to play what you know, play what you don't know.
I did not like the music. And it took me, as I say, 3 to 6 months of these nighttime sessions in these hotels of hearing this music. One night I probably had something to smoke and it's just like, I said, Miles, I think I hear something what you're trying to do. I mean, it dawned on me what he was trying to do.
Musically, it was an incredible, uplifting experience. It was an adventure all of the time. And everyone always gave their all on stage. And we all knew it was an adventure, and we were all searching in our own ways for different forms and different ways of making music.
I learned a whole bunch of new things about Miles when I began playing with him that I didn't realize before. The gift of listening and knowing how to listen, I found that out early in the game with Miles. It was incredible how the notes that came from him were a real combination of his own creativity and his ability to hear what everybody else was playing and incorporate that into kind of this core that would come out of his trumpet. Miles would play a phrase, and then I knew what it was that we were all doing. But it took Miles's voice musically, you know, that sound through his trumpet, and his being able to, his ability to hear what that could be and provide the glue to bring it all together and make it sound like a real band.
There's something about being in the presence of somebody with that kind of personal power. It's not a power that has to be exercised. It's just a power that is, you know, and that's something different to me. If there's somebody that's kind of swaggering around and I'm the hippest, I'm the most powerful, whatever, that doesn't get your attention. But when somebody just is powerful, they have that. They don't have to do a thing. Miles could just walk in a room and everybody would sit up a bit straighter, you know. It's that kind of respect that he commanded. And being around that and being around that intensity every time he put the trumpet to his lips, you know.
That's why every time, this is interesting, I never thought of it like this. When he changed the woman, changing the music, he would also change the musicians. Every band, when he finished with that, when he finished exploring with that particular idiom, he would change to go into the next phase, he understood you needed musicians who can interpret the new music.
Music, so much guitar, so loud. I said, Miles, you really don't need the saxophone. I mean, it's really superfluous. I mean, we're not playing the blues anymore. This is ridiculous. You don't need the saxophone. I'm trying to ace out of a gig, but I got to, you know. He said, people like to see you move your fingers. I said, okay, walk away. Think about that. And it came years later. Charlie Parker, fast, Miles slow. Right away, he saw balance is the key. If you do, I do the other. Coltrane, fast, Miles slow. Wayne Shorter, fast, Miles slow. Basically. And what he was talking about was balance. And that was right. Because if he's going to be the way he plays, and he knew the way he played, he was a stylist in a certain way musically, he needed the antidote. He needed the opposite to make the people, quote, you know, in other words, to make the full statement.
He did this once. I won't tell you what the name of the guy, but there was a drummer, and he was playing all these fills in between. It was a very, very slow tempo. It was like, boom, doo, boom, you know. And he couldn't help himself. He had to keep filling in these blanks. So Miles said, okay, let's do it again. It's the tempo. Okay.
One of the things that was interesting to me after I joined the band, of course, was to then be privileged to watch that process and see how he molded music in the studio and what kind of process he brought to bear. And a lot of the time it was about taking away things rather than putting them in. It was about eliminating the superfluous material and getting down to the essence and using that. And to me, Miles was one of the great minimalists in terms of that, you know, being able to take a very small amount of compositional material, but make it so significant that it would create a whole world for the improviser to work with.
He knew what to bring out in you that if you, I'd venture to say, if you ask the people you're interviewing, and if we would go back in history, I would say, I don't know, a large percentage, what they played in Miles's presence when they were with Miles, they never played like that again. That it was a period. More than just because that was a style of music and then they went out on their own and they changed the style of music. Okay, that's obvious. It's the way they played with Miles was unique to their time with Miles because he was able to see in you what he wanted.
Well, you know, Miles has had such a big effect on all of us. I think that we all carry, you know, the experiences with us that we got from playing with him and the time we spent around him. And I know for me, some of the things that were standard for me remain with me every night that I play, you know. And he set a benchmark for creativity and focus, I think, that we're all reaching for. Those of us that were touched by him. And so I feel that every night, you know, really I'm trying to pay tribute to that with the music that we play.
And Miles is a great treasure that keeps on giving and giving and giving.
Everybody that I know that worked with Miles feels kind of a bond, you know, a connection to each other because we had that connection with Miles. So there's something that Miles kind of gave each of us that is indescribable, that, I don't know, when I see any of the guys that I know that work with Miles, you know, and the subject of Miles comes up, and it's like almost like a little nod that of like knowing what it's like, you know, what we got out of that experience of working with Miles, I really can't put into words, but it's something that once you have that experience, it never leaves you.
Miles Davis doesn't sound like a trumpet. It sounds like a voice. In fact, this is what I love about the best musicians. Best musicians, I don't hear the guitar or the trumpet. They sound like life. Anybody who sounds like a trumpet, I don't listen to him. You know, but Miles doesn't sound like a trumpet. He sounds like life looking at you and sharing experiences with you. Miles picked up something later on that Jimi Hendrix used to do a lot, which just comes from John Lee Hooker. It's called like this. And Miles go. You know, it's called tonguing something. It's, you know, it's very essential, you know, what the tongue does. It's very normal, you know. When you're a kid and somebody puts their tongue in your ear, you know, you're like, oh my God, what was that, you know?
Jazz was evolving. The 60s, that was a revolutionary time. And the further out the music got, the more exploratory the music got, the more the tunes began to work kind of seamlessly on a live concert. Miles would just start playing something, and just from a few cues, we'd know what tune it was. He wouldn't even call tunes anymore. There were certain cues would let us know what we were going into next, and we developed a pretty keen sense of being able to listen to each other and listen to what those cues might be. And so he wouldn't stop between tunes. Before we finished one tune, this idea for another tune would come out, and we'd just shift gears right there and go into the next tune. So there was this kind of seamless kind of flow from one tune to the next.
I did something on Herbie's record, and they were not playing like accompanists. I mean, you could hardly get in on the downbeat because Herbie's in the middle of a figure. That's Miles taught them that. He's playing way over. He's not setting up the downbeat at all. He's in the middle of this crescendo thing, you know, like if I come in, I'm coming in the middle of this moving, glittering shape, you know. So I'm kind of waiting for him. He's descending now. Okay, we're up to two and a half, and I got a lot of words to deliver. How am I gonna get all those syllables in the remaining, you know, half a bar? There's no way I can. I'm gonna have to slide over into the next bar. So that's a thing that those guys did a lot. They slid across the bars, you know. It wasn't the backbeat, you can't lose it. They were trying to lose it, absolutely.
Miles came up to me and sang this beat that I play. And actually, I kind of stick close to it through the track. I think it's called What I Say, I believe. And it's a hell of a track. That's one of my favorite tracks on there. And he said, Jack, he said, play this beat. And he tapped it on my shoulder.
Drummers love Miles because Miles hits the beat better than any drummer. And you can't do that on trumpet very easily because there's all this air, pressure has to build up, and you have to hit. It's not a percussion instrument, but I can't imagine being a drummer and not being in heaven, you know. Because when he plays on one, that will be the one where you ought to be if you're the drummer.
This was a great period. So, of course, critics, people like that, obviously they couldn't see it. But, you know, nobody ever takes a test to be a jazz critic, you know. I mean, you take tests to drive a bus, but you don't take tests to ruin somebody's life, you know. And I love this about jazz criticism. I mean, it's like probably one of the lowest businesses there is.
First of all, every time you do something, you make mistakes, you know, and so you want another shot at it to fix those. They're not the mistakes that the critics point out. They never know where the mistakes are. The things that they call mistakes are probably what's great about it. But what you think are the things that need to be fixed gives you your next period. So you're going onward and you're building off of it. I didn't get that quite right. I'm gonna try something else the next time, you know.
Miles was a great, loving, caring, and very honest musician, you know, when it came to to the music, he was that way. I wouldn't say that he was the perfect human being, because he wasn't. You know, he had other kinds of problems, you know, over the years. But so much of what they had to say that was negative about Miles was because, really, it was because they themselves had problems.
I am aware there was some negative reaction about the music that we were playing, because it was too new, it was too innovative, and also was some electronics involved. And the hardcore, or the so-called purists, jazz purists, they didn't want to hear that stuff. They want to hear Miles Davis going, but Miles, first of all, I don't think Miles could play like that anymore. You see? And he didn't want to play like that anymore, also. See? So he had to stop playing, or he had to invent something new that he would be able to play, and that he would like to play also.
I think it was hard for him sometimes more to hear the criticism from his fellow musicians. There were some musicians of his generation that really put him down and said, you know, you're way off the track here playing this music, you know, you. And I think that might have given him a moment of pause. I mean, it didn't stop him. I wouldn't think for a moment it occurred to him not to do that. But I think it must have been hard to find that, you know, there were musicians who weren't able to stay on the journey with him, not even to play the music, but just to follow it and to understand what he was doing.
I remember the first time he called me, he said, man, I'm losing black people. He said, fewer and fewer black people are coming to see. He said, you know what, the music is moving too far away from our people. That was On the Corner. On the Corner was the result of that. Now, when I say overtly, look at the cover of On the Corner. It's all black characters we know from the street. You got the pimp, the hustler, then there's a guy that, like with the Tam, like the Black Panthers, say, you know, vote for me. That wasn't something he did to sell more records. That's what this was, because when we did the album, it got canned. But he was more overtly, more outspoken about where he was coming from in terms of as a black man in America.
Him not caring about the audience was completely a lie. He cared so much about the presentation that he would make. I never saw him turn his back to the audience. I saw him face the band. I saw him direct the band. If his back happened to be in front of the audience, that's because he was doing another kind of activity with the band to make the music better.
If you're an artist and you feel what your intuition tells you the path you're on is that's right for you, then nothing can stop that.
I mean, if you're in the moment, you're bound to fall. But you don't ever fall so far that anyone notices except your closest teammates. They say, man, he's about to fall. Well, let's catch him. Let's play the right chord for him. It's like a trapeze with the safety net below. The safety net are the other guys. They're watching out for you in the cause of the music. Not so much to help you, but to the music. And we're supposed to teeter and totter because we're trying things. And if you're in the spirit of improvisation, it can't be planned. You don't know what you're going to do next. You sort of know, but you're experimenting, and you're also working with the 3, 4, or 5 people around you. Hey, mistakes happen. It's great. I love it.
You know, another way you could put it is instant composition in a collective way. And the best jazz has this interactive response between the musicians, that they're anticipating each other. And the best of the best anticipate each other in a way that feels so natural it could have been written, and that they've practiced it. And one of the great things about Miles, that I know you know, is that he insisted on not rehearsing. And I remember, I believe he fired George Coleman for that reason, because he heard him practicing his solos in the hotel room. He said, I don't pay you to practice your solos. You're supposed to not know what you're going to play when you go on that stage. He didn't say that, but that's what he meant. You just see the incredible technical demands placed on an improvisational musician, to, especially in the context of an interactive ensemble. So maybe there's something transcendentally beautiful in the idea of humans having this equality. Maybe this is a metaphor for something. Maybe, you know, I don't want to say democracy, because that word has been so bandied about, and it's, but something of humanity as co-equals or something like that. There's something very special about it, and I think that America was the country that it had to be born in, because that concept is at the foundation of your constitution.
So there's this give and take and sharing and support that goes on in the band. To me, the music represents almost at its best anyway, an ideal of what a social structure can be in a society, you know, where people can be individuals, they can really be themselves, but at the same time can work together and create something which is unified and shared with each other.
Miles chose me to be in his group on a recommendation from a sax player, from Bill Evans, the sax player, who was also in the band at the time. He just said, hey, I need a bass player. I need a funky bass player. Find me a funky bass player. And Bill said, oh, you should try Marcus. Simple as that. When I first got introduced to music, it was drums, electric bass. It was electric piano. You know, it was guitar, electric guitars. So that's what I'm saying is that, you know, that became my language. You know, that became the language that my first language that I spoke. And a lot of guys like me, you know. So we eventually went back and discovered acoustic music, you know. I was even surprised when people asked me what instrument I played. I said, I play, you know, bass guitar. They go, oh, do you play upright too? And I go, why would I play upright? You know, do people still do that? You know, this is me at 15, 16 years old. I'll tell you, you know, the thing about that concert that's interesting for me, that's really fascinating for me, is to watch, because it's like witnessing a crossroads. You know, what happened was, to me, was that Miles had these guys who had been brought up in this jazz tradition, and he had them playing, you know, funk and rock, you know? And you could tell they weren't comfortable with it, or you, I could feel that they weren't comfortable with playing this rock music. But they had so much respect for Miles that they did it anyway, and you can hear the struggle in that music. You can hear these jazz musicians trying to acclimate themselves to this new language with no chord changes and very strict rhythm pulse, you know, and you can hear them fighting it. You know, you can tell that they did what they did with Miles because of Miles, because Miles wanted to try it and Miles wanted to push. And they said, well, let's push with Miles. I didn't experience the one in the 70s, but I was there for the 80s, the hostile reaction, you know. There was, Miles, I think, was always creating hostile reactions, and I think I always looked at it in a positive light. I said, you know, Miles, what this means is that what you did 10 years ago moved people so much and was so important to them and so much a part of their lives that when you stopped doing it, they felt abandoned. You know, they felt like, how could you do this to me, Miles? How could you make me feel old like this? How could you make me feel irrelevant like this? You know? And I can understand how somebody would feel that way, you know? I joined this band, I think, in 81 or 82, and it was the same thing. It was basically a continuation of what he was doing here, you know, where there were a lot of vamps that became like trances, or they were supposed to become like trances. And then Miles would paint pictures on top of him. Every once in a while, he and the sax player would play melodies to kind of focus everybody or to change the color, you know. But it was really very African and very trance-oriented, where it's just keep playing this thing till people get lost in it and keep changing the colors above the rhythm, you know. Yeah, we became pretty tight, you know, and I can't tell you why. I, you know, one of the reasons might have been because by that time, by the time I met Miles, I was familiar with just about his entire life, musically, you know what I mean? And we could talk about anything in music. But I think he also respected that I was committed to now, you know? I love that music, I play it, you know, I practice it, but when it's time for me to say what I have to say, I'm committed to making music for now. Well, you know, I never noticed Miles' hands, but an artist friend of mine, Chaz Guest, did. And he told me, man, I'll tell you, Miles' hands are as distinctive as his face and his music, you know? And he did this, the sculpture of Miles' hands. And I gotta admit, as soon as I saw it, I said, whoa, that is him, you know? Just the way they're shaped and the way the joints are, you know, the thumb kind of has a protruding character to it. And it has a strength to it, you know? Play something as a tribute to Miles.
For me personally, music is the language of light. Whether it's Beethoven, Miles Davis, Bob Marley, Marvin Gaye, John Coltrane, Mahalia Jackson, at the peak of their excellence, at the peak of their everythingness, music reminds the listener that we come from the light and we're just visiting this planet and we're going to return to the light. So I would say music is the language of light.
And I think we're constantly, we got these kind of core melodies in our souls. And all musicians do is just give you versions of them. Change it, ignore it, or play it. And that affects us.
Whatever you want to call it, it's beyond us, it's beyond our, you know, flesh and blood. It's eternal, everlasting, universal. It's been here since the beginning. It's going to go on past us. And if you can get linked to it, boy, you're a lucky guy. And if you can be linked to it and translated to somebody else, messenger of God.
Well, it's the organization of energy fields. Without killing them. so that those energy fields can be transformed into sound. We're renting a little tiny condo for the moment in the universe of sound and doing our little, you know, a humble job of organizing a speck of sonic debris that might otherwise have gone unnoticed by a bunch of people with ears.
I've read some Sufi readings, and they say that the universe actually started because of music. The noise, it got to a certain pitch, and the noise was at a certain frequency, and it created the Big Bang.
It's a miracle.
It's possibly the best thing that human beings can do. And I think that the universe is created like a piece of music. So perhaps we get closer to the creator when we are doing music.
I go with my feelings, you know, I love music. The only thing that makes me play and continue in this business is my love for music.